many of us face immense challenges in our lives. I want to uncover secrets and principles to building a life filled with purpose, not weighed down by hardship. I'm Kirsty, your host in this journey. Each episode, I'll be talking to different people, sharing their stories and practical steps to help us to design a life that we love. Joining us today, we have Medina Labarkin. So welcome, Medina. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's wonderful to chat with you.
It's great. I can't wait to see where our conversation goes. And for our listeners, Medina, you're based in Melbourne and you're a holistic life coach.
Correct.
And you work mostly with women and children. Is that right?
Correct. I do have a few men, but predominantly, yes, women and some children, yes.
And Medina has a wonderful Facebook group called Parents After Kids, and it's all about everyday living, living your best life, but including your family members, so your children, your partners, and all the good things that go alongside that.
So Medina, do you want to just tell us a little bit about yourself? Things like the way that you spend your time, what you get up to, what you're excited about in your life?
Well, I grew up in Templestowe, part of, Victoria. And I found when I was my daughter was about 2 years old, that she was going through the terrible twos and being quite challenging. So then I got on the path of learning to meditate and sort of a more holistic way of being. And I followed that path and did a whole lot of holistic training in different modalities, became a Reiki master and things like that. And then I found that I really love working with people and helping them with all sorts of areas, issues in their lives, and combining my work with all the things that I learned. So it's quite holistic, based on mental, spiritual, emotional, physical aspects. And it was good for me too, because, you know, as we all do, I went through a lot of challenges in my life. I think, you know, that's what life is. You know, you have the good times and you have the challenging times. And when I went through the death of a child, she was due to be born, her name was Georgia, in 1999, and she passed when she was due to be born. So that was an incredible growth experience, actually. You know, often these darkest challenges are the most, the biggest learning experiences. And so then I really found that I was drawing on a lot of the skills that I'd been learning, and, you know, I learned more and was able to use them to help other people. And, you know, I went through a divorce, so that again was very challenging with three kids. And you know, those are the sort of things, I think, which give us also the gifts that we can use to help others. And so that experience of single parenting and also looking at my parents' history of parenting, because they had challenges when they were growing up, my parents, because my mum's mum died when she was 11 and her father couldn't look after her, so she was shipped off to be looked after by an aunt and a family friend. And my father's father left the family house when he was 14, and he was never seen again. He just basically left. And so I look at these parenting types, situations that we've encountered, and, you know, in my ancestry, and I think, well, you know, parenting is such an enormous job, and there are so many areas where parents require support today. Another factor is, of course, our Western culture is very insular, so we don't have the extended families necessarily, or the support systems that other cultures have. So again, the parenting situation becomes challenging, and you feel quite isolated when you're going through these difficult stages with kids. So, you know, that all formed who I am and what I do today. And the things you asked me, the things that I love, and I love being creative. So I'm actually a singer-songwriter, so I've had international songs published and had a song in a movie.
Wow. Which movie is it?
Well, there's a movie overseas called Love a la Carte, and it showed at Cannes Film Festival, and I think it was 2014, and our song is in that. And also I had an international film company want to make a video of one of my songs, which was really beautiful. I was so blessed, called the Denou Film Productions, French international company. And so that was really exciting. So I've had some, you know, really fun things happen with the music. And then I've been a published author, so I've written books, and I'm up to about the seventh book now that I've written. And so that's been really fun. And I also love, you know, working with people. I work with a lot of, actually it's interesting what you magnetise, because you know, you put out your energy and you just see what comes in. And it's funny how you magnetize the same thing all the time. I'm drawing in a lot of wonderful women who are really highly skilled and really, really capable. And they're finding that at this moment on the earth, and I think it's a global transition that's happening, people are becoming very unhappy with their work. They're feeling that their work that they're doing is not in alignment with who they are now, with their soul. So I'm drawing in these women who want to change and go into often their own sort of area of work that they really love and that they feel really represents who they are, expresses their authentic self. It's their way of giving to the world. And they're wanting to step into that and make that successful now. And as an adjunct to that, I've heard that in 2017 it's predicted that in Australia, 50% of all people in jobs are dissatisfied and will be looking to want to change their career. So I do think it's a real global transition. Energetically, there's a big shift happening and things are changing and people are feeling it and they're wanting to be representing their authentic selves. So yeah, I think that's it in a nutshell.
That is exciting. That's brilliant. I know exactly what you're talking about. I think I read an article just last week about this, about how people were so unsatisfied. But I mean, I see this as well. So I'm a health coach and I work with a lot of women. I see as well just that need to really connect with the inner self and to do something which is a lot more worthwhile, that we feel creates value, adds value to the world, is releasing us into our true purpose. I see it all the time and it's growing and growing. So I absolutely love to hear what you're saying. I'm totally in alignment with what you're saying. Yes. I just love all the things that you've talked about. So you've talked about doing your songs, you've talked about singing, you've talked about helping people, all of these great things. I just want to go back. You touched on something and it was almost quite a shock for me that you know, you went through this experience where you had a stillborn, your daughter, Georgia?
She was, yes, actually.
Yeah. So yes. You had no warning that that was coming, no warning that there might be something wrong or indication that things weren't going as planned?
Well, not physically, not in the physical sense. However, it was interesting because I was at a Mind Body Spirit Festival just prior and I thought, oh, well, that'll be fun. I'll get a quick reading. I was with a friend. And the lady that gave me the quick reading, she basically inferred that something was going to go wrong, but she wouldn't say it in those words because, you know, they're, generally speaking, they're not supposed to talk that way. But she did infer it. And then I had some other friends doing a circle and again, a similar sort of thing came up, but I didn't relate it to the baby that I was carrying. So on that metaphysical level, I did get a few signs that it wasn't going to manifest. And also I had a spiritual midwife and we connected on the inner with the child before she was born. And I would ask her questions about, you know, what she was going to bring into my life when she was born. And she would never talk about that like in the future tense. She'd only talk in the present tense and say things like, I love you. And so there wasn't any sort of long-term picture. So when I piece all those things together, I can see that she wasn't actually going to necessarily incarnate. But you know, it was an experience, I think, that really built a lot of character within me and it made me realize how strong I was and how much I could cope with. And I felt actually through that experience, I did help a lot of other people through that experience, even though I was the mum, because it would bring up people's bring up people's pain and their sadness. And so I found that I was, you know, supporting quite a lot of people through that experience while also going through it myself. And, you know, it was for me what it felt like was normally I'm very connected to the beauty of life and light and I have a sort of a lightness and you know, normally I go to sleep at night and I see all these beautiful colours and flowers and all these gorgeous things. And, you know, when I went through that experience, it was just went black and there was like a dark tunnel. So I felt like I was going through this long dark tunnel. And one of the ways that I used to get through that was to write. So I wrote a book, which I've never published. It's just for me, really. But it was for about 2 months. I just wrote a lot and it was so cathartic. It really helped.
Yeah, that's great. So how was it in those early days when this has all just happened? Was Georgia your first? Was she going to be your first?
No, she was my third child.
Your third, okay. So how did you maintain the rhythm of life and look after your other children? And that time you were married, weren't you?
I was, yes.
So how did you manage to keep all of those balls in the air whilst grieving something which is so traumatic and, you know, changes everything?
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Well, you know, I can tell you how traumatic it was from one main experience that I remember, which, you know, our sense of smell, the olfactory sense, is very connected to our emotions. They're very closely connected within the body. And I remember holding this beautiful baby and smelling her, and she wasn't alive. I mean, that's just a killer. It's you know, your whole system can sense that, and I still have a strong memory of that to this day, of course. But I think for me, I have sort of a sense of you just have to get through this, and it's like gritting your teeth and going through it and harnessing all your sort of inner skills that you have and bringing them all into play at once. And also I have a strong sense of the people around me. So obviously I had two little girls to look after, and that was enormous, and there were things that were really helpful to them, like the ceremonial things, you know, ways of honouring Georgia being here in the physical, that were helpful to the young children, and, you know, being able to talk about it freely with them. My husband at that time, he already had bipolar depression, and so he found that the experience made him grieve intensively, and he basically just cried nonstop for, it was at least 7 days.
Wow.
Nonstop. And so he was not coping at all, but I saw this experience as being cathartic for him in the sense that it allowed him to release all this pent-up sadness that he'd been holding on to. So on a long-term, you know, basis, it was actually healing for him. But yes, I had to carry him, the kids, and you know, family members were deeply upset as well. And, you know, and then you'd have people that you knew not that well, you know, they'd come up to you and they say, "Oh, how's the baby?" And then you'd have to deal with that sort of thing. I remember one lady came up to me and she was due to have a baby around the same time, and she had her baby in a pram, and she goes, "Oh, where's your baby?" And I said, "Look, I'm really sorry. I just want to tell you that, you know, my baby actually died." And she goes, "Oh, really? Okay." And she just had a really strange reaction, but that was her way of trying to deal with it. So she said something like, "Oh, what colour nail polish have you got?"
Oh, really?
She tried to make it really positive and happy, and you know, that was just her way of trying to cope with it. So, you know, you get all these unusual sort of and interesting sort of responses, and so it, you know, it's just, you know, people doing the best that they can in a difficult situation.
Yeah. You know, it's so great that you could recognise that, because it would be very easy to get very upset by the way that she reacted to that. I think you're right, though. It is the way that we deal with things. We've all got our different ways of doing that. So well done on recognizing that at the time when your world was completely falling apart. Yep.
Well, yes. I mean, the thing is, I think the thing that really carries me through too is that I have a holistic, spiritual, metaphysical perspective on life. So I'm not seeing that there is only just this life. I think we've had many, many lives, and this is one of them. And if something challenging happens to you, I have this thing where it's like I go into a space where it's like when you're looking at a play, you know, you're sitting up in the audience and you're watching the play or happening on the stage, but there's a certain level of objectivity that you can create in that situation, understanding that these are just experiences I'm going through for whatever reason. I've probably chosen these experiences when I asked to come in, you know, I've chosen them for whatever learning I've needed to, create. And I often ask too, what might I be learning through this experience? What have I asked to learn? You know, so for example, through the experience of Georgia passing, maybe I'm learning my inner strength. You know, what qualities is this bringing to me that I'm learning? And so I try and look at it in a bit of a, like a distant way, which doesn't mean, you know, that you're not feeling it, because I still feel everything intensively. Mm-hmm. And, you know, but it's understanding it from that perspective that it's not the be all and end all. It's not all there is. You know, there are many, many lifetimes. This is one of them. And, you know, this is just the learning for this lifetime. So I think that really, really helps when you have that type of perspective on life. And I'd like to just say too, I mean, I get confirmation of this all the time. I don't need confirmation because I believe it at a deep level. But my son, when he was little, one of his very first words was, he'd hold me tightly and squeeze me with passion, you know, and he'd say, "Gadish, Gadish," and I'm thinking, I wonder what this word means. It was, you know, this really passionate, powerful word that he would say, and he'd say it whenever he was feeling like, you know, like he was feeling love, and he was cuddling me, and he'd say, "Gadish, Gadish," and you know, this went on for probably about nearly 2 years.
Wow.
And I'm thinking, oh, I wonder what that word means. And then one day I was watching the movie Jesus of Nazareth, and Jesus was walking into the temple.
Yep.
And in the old Aramaic language, they said, oh, and now Jesus walks into the Gadish. And
and you're like, what?
Exactly. And I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, that's the word.
Yeah.
And it's interesting because temple is one of my favorite things. I grew up in Templestowe. I love temples. I when I do my healings, I work in temple space, for goodness. I love them. And here is this little tiny thing and saying with passion over and over, temple, temple.
Oh, that is so great. So is that where you get that from, your certainty of, I guess, your spiritual beliefs and that you talked about previous lives and things where you've been able to stay positive and really embrace the opportunity to learn rather than to get angry? Does that come from your upbringing, your childhood experiences?
No, not at all. No. There was no talk of any of this stuff when I was growing up.
So where does that come from? Because it seems so solid in your life right now.
Thank you. That's a very good question. I like the way you worded that. That was really clever. I guess it's a divine timing thing. You know, it just sort of kicked in when it was ready. I think there's a certain level of maturity that you gain when you have children. So when I was, as I mentioned, when my daughter was two, I really started to investigate this more spiritual aspect of life, and it sort of really kicked in. And I'd had an urge to learn meditation prior to that, but it hadn't really kicked in. And you know, throughout my whole childhood, there was no mention of any of this at all whatsoever. So no basis there. So I guess, you know, there's a thing called an awakening that happens with people where, for whatever reason, you know, the experience of life, or it's the right time in terms of divine timing, they have an awakening where they connect to a larger sense of what there is. And that happened to me. And I noticed sometimes I've been doing work with clients, because with the coaching, I also incorporate healing, spiritual healing. Mm-hmm. And quite a few times I've had clients where their eyes have gone from being dull to their eyes have gone shiny and clear, and they've had this sense of, oh, I get it. There's more to things than what I thought before. So there is a definite crossover point where, and often it, you see it in the eyes. It's fascinating.
Yeah, it's great, isn't it? I see that with my clients as well in a different way, but some of them, their eyes literally just clear up, and it's like they have a different perspective, and everything changes from that point onwards. It's absolutely amazing.
You know, I did one with a person in Queensland, and that exact thing happened. The eyes went from being dull to being shiny, and they just had this greater sense of connection to the divine, or whatever you want to call that higher sense. And we stepped outside, and for half a day there was this incredible migration of these beautiful butterflies over our heads, with blue spots on their wings. For half a day that happened after this person had this awakening. And I firmly believe those two things were strongly associated. It was just magical.
That's beautiful, isn't it? Love it. Yeah. Okay, I just want to track back a little bit. So you've been talking about how you went through this quite dark experience, and that how you've come through it, your spiritual beliefs, and how you've got to a more positive place today. What would you suggest for perhaps some of our listeners are at that dark point right now, or they're just coming out of that? What are some practical steps that you could suggest that they could implement in their lives? How do they get from that place to getting back on the road and starting to live their life again?
Sure, absolutely. Well, there's a few main things that I would recommend. One of the things is our natural instinct when we feel pain is to try to avoid it or suppress it and to distance ourselves from it. But the more you're able to honor that emotion by actually going in and allowing yourself to feel it, actually you're able to work through it far more quickly. Mm-hmm. And you're able to transmute it quicker. So I would encourage people to give themselves the space, the time, and you know, be courageous and go in and feel where that pain is in the body. I mean, when we experience pain, it's not created externally from an outside thing that's happened to us. We already have that within us. So it's just bringing up what we already have. So it's bringing it up. Often these things bring it up so that we can release it and heal it and transmute it. So the more that you can go in and actually make a friend of that pain, in a sense, the more you will be able to work through it quickly. You'll be able to get the gifts from it. And that's one of the major things that I would say.
So you're saying to actually embrace the experience, and rather than shut it down and avoid it, to actually glow through it.
Or the emotion of the experience. So, you know, for example, you're feeling deep trauma or deep pain in your body, go into your body, breathe. And working with breath is really important. Breathe, go into that feeling. Where is it in your body? What does it feel like? What does it look like? And then you know, I've got certain techniques that I do with clients now at this point, which I can't really describe in full here, but you go into it, you feel it, you connect with it, you breathe with it, and you'll find that after a period, the extreme sort of heightened sense of it will start to dissipate, and it will be able to be sort of transmuted and released if you actually go right into the depths of those feelings within yourself and feel them. And you know, it takes a lot of courage. You know, it's very confronting, of course, but this you'll find that, you know, instead of having to live with the trauma of an emotion for a long period of time, if you actually do it that way, you can work through it much quicker. But it's honoring that emotion. You know, it's different for different people, takes different times for different people to work through. And my other point too would be to be really conscious of being present in the current moment. So, you know, it's all the things that Eckhart Tolle talked about in his book, The Power of Now.
Yeah, great. So,
yes. So instead of going into the past, I mean, generally speaking, whenever you go into the past, you tend to be going into some sort of negativity or a drop in terms of your emotions. So, I mean, of course, you can think about positive experience in the past. That's different. But often when we go back and look on past experiences, they are ones which can drag us down. So the joy that we experience is so much easier to connect with when we're in the present moment. I mean, really, they do say that if you really want to be in your true sense of joy, you need to be fully present in the present moment. So 100% here, I'm right here, right here, right now. And, you know, you can say an affirmation, I am right here, right now, fully present in this moment. And then just bring all your energy 100% into this moment. And you'll find it's very difficult to be in your sadness when you are 100% centered in that present moment, and also not going into the future. There's an amazing book by Jean-Paul Sartre called The Existentialist, and it's all to do with this sort of thing. It was this interesting character, and he did something and he was thrown in jail, but because he was fully centered in the present moment, he was sitting in the jail cell, and a little filter of light was streaming through the window onto his face, and he was feeling the light, and he was feeling how wonderful, you know, he felt at that moment because the light was on his face. He wasn't thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going to be here another 20 years, because he wasn't thinking about the future. He was just 100% centered. And I think that is a really fantastic metaphor for how to be fully present in the present moment and still be in your joy, because that's what it is. It's being in that moment. And so that those are two really major things, I think.
I think that's fantastic. That is something that I've spent a lot of my life working on. I'm very much a future person. I spend a lot of my time in the future. And it's only when I realize that I've missed out on something right in front of me, or something happened and I wasn't even, you know, I was there and I went through it, but I just completely missed it.
Oh, it's
that
so...
I've had to actually train myself to be in the now.
Absolutely.
Myself back. So even now, like my next question for you, I want to move into the future. So you've talked about being in the present, you've talked about the past. How much do you think we can create our future?
Okay, well, this is the $20 million question.
Yeah. I know. We've all got different opinions, so it's not going to be right or wrong. Or
No. Yeah. Absolutely. Well, you know, the more – I will preface this by saying the more I know, the more I realise I don't know.
Yeah, exactly. I so relate to that.
I'll try to answer the question. So I think we do have free will. I also think we incarnate and we have sort of like soul contracts or things that we've decided that we want to work on in this lifetime, and we create them to learn, you know, what we've asked to learn. So often the people that are the most difficult in our lives are actually our greatest gift, because they've come in to help us with things we asked to be helped with.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, exes and all that. So I think that in terms of creating our future, we do have a certain amount of free will for sure. But I just think that if we think human beings really want to control everything, you know, we have this sense of that we're the master, we're in control. But I don't think that is necessarily the case, because often our vision for ourselves is much more limited than the divine or the higher version of what we are really supposed to be doing, and we can't even conceive that because we are limited in our thoughts. So you don't want to be you know, limiting yourself by having really strict, strong views of what you're doing, where you're going, that are actually under what you can fully achieve, if that makes sense. So I think that we can certainly have things that we're aiming for, like visions, and we can work towards those. There's a wonderful technique where you can work with your future self, your ideal self, and draw that energy in by working with that being and drawing your best, most, you know, self-actualized ideal life. And yet at the same time, it's being open to even higher opportunities that you may not be aware of. So it's a bit of a balance.
Yeah. And I can definitely see that in, well, definitely my life. So then if you are you're quite good now at being in the now and focusing on the present moment.
Oh, I'm not brilliant, I have to say, but I do my best and I am aware of it. But there's this thing in the center, you know, your solar plexus center, and that is your center for empowerment. And so this is the point at which you do a technique to draw yourself into the now. It all comes from that point. So, you know, there are certain exercises and techniques you can do as well for that.
Yeah. So then how much do you consider everyday things that are in the now? How much do you think about your current actions or consequences or where the things that you do on a daily basis, where they're taking you? Do you think about those things very much? Or are you more focused on being and seeing where life takes you?
Well, that's a good question. I think that I try to not think too much about the future. I have a bit of an idea of where I'm wanting to go, a vision, and I work towards that very, you know, I work quite hard with the work that I'm doing. I've got a really strong purpose of what I want to put into the world. So, you know, I do focus on that every day and I'm, you know, quite passionate about that. But I think that it's, I sort of try and leave it open. I don't know.
Yeah, not much of a planner then, is that fair to say?
Well, a general plan that's there of what I'm wanting to create, but open to even bigger possibilities.
Yeah. And I love that. I love how we are very different. I think it's wonderful. So you talked there that you've got some plans and you're really focused on what you want to share with the world. What is it that you want to share with the world? What's your biggest message and what are you hoping to do with your life to get out there and help people?
Sure, thank you. Well, as we mentioned, I'm very interested in helping our parents, and not only happily married parents, but parents who are separated, parents who are divorced. You know, there's a lot of parents out there experiencing great challenges with kids because the level of parental estrangement in Western society and parental alienation is extremely high. And I even just had a message from one of the members this morning talking about how she's experienced this, and she's having great difficulty with that. So my group is to support all parents. I mean, even parents whose kids leave home and they find that really difficult. So supporting parents in that process, which therefore supports kids as well. And helping people to realize their highest potential. So that's through the holistic coaching, helping women to empower themselves to be in their best possible career job. Also, I've got a kids club that I'm launching on the 20th of November, which is the United Nations International Children's Day, and that club is going to be for kids who have any sort of challenges in their everyday life. It's from 6 to 12 years, and you know, kids that, you know, they want to build their inner core, you know, a solid foundation on the inner, or parents that would like their children to build that, because, you know, school focuses on a lot of external things, but I think that kids need a really strong inner solid foundation within themselves that gets them through life and, you know, building things like self-confidence. There was a little girl I worked with the other day and I said to her, what would you like to work on? She said she was feeling shy. So we did some techniques to allow her to work with that. And she wrote to me a little letter afterwards and she said, oh, that was awesome. I love this work. So cute.
That's brilliant. Yeah. So how old was she, sorry?
She was 10.
Oh, and, that's brilliant.
Yeah, so I think this work is really, really important for kids. So I'm having 6 sessions with kids online, and we do it as a group on Zoom, and we work on their issues of what the things that they're finding challenging in their lives, and fantastic techniques, visualizations, meditations to work on that. So I'm passionate about helping kids and parents, adults.
Yeah, everyone, it sounds like. yeah, great.
Yeah, and I love it so much. And I've done years and years of, you know, training and study, and I'm very curious about life. So I like to learn about everything. And now, because I am older, I feel like I've got something really valuable that I can give to others, and in the form of all the things that I've learned and how to help people. That's, I mean, I have pursued other things in life, for example, the music and the singing, but on some level it didn't really take off in the way that I was hoping for at that time. But that's because I feel that, you know, there is another purpose for me, which is, you know, what I'm doing now. So that's all really good. And I've got a 7-day challenge as well for parents at the minute, teaching parenting relationship type skills. It's free, and it's really fantastic videos that people can work through to, you know, be at their very best. And that's, if you go to Parents After Kids on the Facebook page, I'll be able to tell you about where to go for that as well.
That's brilliant. We'll put all of the links to these things in the notes so that our listeners can go there. This is really great stuff. So I do suggest that if you're listening to this, do jump on, have a little look, especially if you've got kids, if you're wanting some support or some help in any way, which I think all of us as parents go through. Definitely get into that, get in there. That is wonderful. So what are you excited about in the future? Here we are, back to the future, because that's the way I work. What are you excited about in your life and things to come?
Okay, well, personally in my life, I'm finding that everything that I'm doing is really starting to take off fully. And, for example, my group, we've got 1,200 and something members now. This happened relatively quickly and it's just booming. I'm getting amazing testimonials from members saying how much they love it, how much it's helping them, because it's got, you know, free resources, information. So that to me is so exciting. And being able to put my own stamp in the world in my own little way, you know, leaving a footprint that's positive, trying in my own personal life to be as kind as I can, and in every single interaction with every being, you know, from animals to people, trying to do that on a personal level. And in terms of the planet, I'm extremely excited because if you look at general media, you're seeing this massive negativity arising, you know, in newspapers, on the TV, things like this. But I find from my experience, if I tune into what I'm feeling, this year 2016 has been incredible. The energy has really shifted this year. There's a real lightness that wasn't here before. And there's a real awakening around the planet where people are becoming more and more aware of all the things that we've discussed, you know, higher purposes, something higher than themselves, whatever you want to call it, God, Buddha, whatever. And I think this can be really felt, you know, in the ethers for people that are working as healers, light workers, you know, with positive, wanting to make a positive difference in the world. We're far more supported more now this year than ever before. I'm feeling it. I'm really feeling it, because it's also indicated in the fact that when I do things, it works far more successfully. Whereas in the past, it felt like things were sort of more challenging and there were more obstacles and things were harder to create. But this year, boy, it's been fantastic.
That is so great. I think you're right. I think people are becoming a lot more open to it and really starting to take their own personal action towards this. I think you're completely right.
Yeah. And feeling that there's something more to life than just themselves. You know, they're feeling people more and more a sense of community. There's so many incredible initiatives happening this year with, you know, people wanting to work on, you know, communal basis to do all sorts of things. I'm seeing some wonderful things happening up on the net for kids, you know, groups for kids to help kids in all sorts of variety of ways. And, you know, if you look on the net, there's throughout the world, there's amazing improvements and changes to the old structure, you know, the way that society has been set up in terms of education, political, government, everything, corporations. We're all starting to realise that this is now redundant. It doesn't align with the energy of who we are as human beings at this time on the planet, and it all needs to change, and it is changing. It's going to massively change over the next few years. And even though there will be, of course, an element of upheaval and challenge within that, if we keep that vision, which you're talking about, you know, thinking of the future, if we keep that vision of our own utopia, of what we want to have in the world and what we want to create, then, you know, I think that's going to draw it in as well. And I see that really starting to happen in a big, big way for the first time this year. I can really feel it. And I'm extremely excited about that, because I want this world to be the beautiful world that I know we can have, of peace, love, harmony. We all work together, help one another. Everyone is supported. Everyone's equal. And all animals, all beings, all souls.
That is absolutely wonderful. Love it. And yeah, I just want to take some time. We've talked about some quite heavy things today. Like, you've had some really big things in your past. You're so positive and you've got this great outlook, and it's just so easy to listen to you talk about your dreams and your passions and the things in your life. It's so easy because I think it's coming from a very genuine place. But just also to acknowledge that it hasn't always been that easy, that there have been dark times, and you've used those times to really build your future and to build the place that you're at now. So,
absolutely.
Well done.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, no, I don't want to discount the fact that, you know, I have been through some extraordinarily challenging things, you know, and there's more, of course, as there.
Yeah, we've barely touched on either. I was thinking there's so much more in there. We've barely touched on them. But
use them all for good, hopefully.
yeah, that is really great. So you've talked about your Facebook group. We'll put your connections, your social media connections, in the notes. Is that Facebook group where you spend most of your time online?
Well, I also have a website called mycreativetherapies.com, and it's got all my testimonials from people for the work they've done, and it's got the video on there, which is a bit of fun, and on my books. So I spend a bit of time on that website. It also talks about the holistic coaching. I should say I'm currently offering 2 free sessions as well. So you can hop on board, have those free sessions, and if you're aligned with the work, you know, you may choose to continue. If not, you'll get benefit from those sessions anyway.
Yeah, that's right.
But in terms of being online, you know, there's some really great websites out there. There's one I really love called the eraofpeace.com, www.eraofpeace.com, with Tricia Cota-Robles. She's amazing. And yeah, there's some really incredibly powerful resources now on the internet that we can tap into. Just the other day, I got this amazing video of Maya Angelou talking, giving her top 10 tips for her ways of getting through life. And she had a really harrowing childhood, but she said that every experience that she's had, even the really traumatic ones, she's been able to turn them around and get the positive out of them.
Oh, that's brilliant, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
We now have more resources at our disposal for all these incredible things than we've ever had before.
I know. It's just brilliant. It's almost giving us less reasons for excuses, or, you know, I feel a personal responsibility as well to get out there and just to make the best out of everything, even all the bad situations, just turn them around, find the positive, keep going, and help somebody else.
Exactly.
If it's not going to help me. Yeah.
Oh, I love it. That's a great point, Kirsty, because when you get the focus off yourself, then, and you're in service of others, straight away there's an enormous shift within yourself.
Absolutely.
That is also one of the other points that I'd like to make about when you're going through trauma, step outside of yourself and help someone else, because that's a really powerful way to get through as well.
Yeah, I totally agree. Well, thank you, Medina. This has been absolutely wonderful. I have really enjoyed talking to you. I love the energy that you're giving. I love the positivity that you're sending out as well. So thank you so much for coming on and chatting to us.
Well, thank you, Kirsty. I really love being here. It was so fun talking to you, and I really value the opportunity to speak about, you know, what I personally think is powerful. And I think you know, having these types of forums to get people talking is so very important at this time. And so I really honour you for, you know, what you're doing. So thank you.
Yeah, that is great. So I look forward to hearing more in the future. maybe hearing some of the other stories that you've been through. So thank you for coming on, and I will put all of your details in our notes so that our listeners can find you.
Oh, that's brilliant. Thank you again.
Great. Thank you.